All righty, cool beans. Welcome, 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 everybody. Welcome to Pimps Fundamental and Technical Forex class. Tonight we're going to be covering the fundamentals of the global financial markets and the technicals of the global financial market. And so I go ahead and hand it over to our chief fundamentalist, Carmen, so she can go ahead and hop on the fundamentals. It's all yours, Carmen.
Okay, hey everybody. So I'm going to get started tonight with going over charts. That was something we talked about on the last Zoom call that I would go over with you guys tonight. I am also going to talk just a little bit about a trading plan and how to develop a trading plan. I'm actually going to do it in more detail on another Zoom call, but I want you guys to kind of get the gist of what to know and how to actually go about formulating a trade. So with that being said, I'm gonna go ahead and share my screen and we'll get started. Okay, I'm gonna do this first and then I'll go back and talk about all the news that happened today. So on the screen, you see a chart. This is EuroCAD. It's the euro versus the Canadian dollar. This is a pair we don't look at. I wanted to pull up a pair that we've never looked at before, a pair I haven't looked at in months, so that we can really get a good idea of how to go about trying to figure out and formulate a trade. So what I typically do with a pair that I've never looked at before is I'll go out to either the monthly or the weekly time frame. It's just a higher time frame. Doesn't necessarily matter which one you go to. I'll show you the difference between the two time frames. So this is the monthly. So the monthly will give you years worth of time. So when you pull up any chart and you go up top and change the time frame, clicking the button that's to the right of the pair, it's going to give you all the times. The higher you go, the more space and the more distance you're going to see between what's down here on the bar that shows you the time. So right now we're currently looking at about 16 years worth of time. And as you can see, if you just glanced at this, you see that EuroCAD has been in an uptrend. But remind you, this is the monthly time frame. So there's a lot of pips in that one candlestick that you see. So I'm going to go down to the weekly time frame and just kind of dial it in. So this will be a good reference to start. This is a good area to actually go in and just look at what is this pair doing right now. So right now we have about, this is 3 full years. We just started 2021, but 3 full years of data here on this chart. So someone in the group today was asking about, you know, how to look at charts, how to formulate trades, how to do their analysis. So I'm getting ready to actually go through, show you what I do on the charts. And I'm going to change it up a little bit just so that you guys can do it and you don't have to feel like you have to get it exactly the way that I do it. I'm going to stop sharing my screen for 1 second because I need to take some indicators off of my chart. Okay, so on this chart, what I'm going to do is change these candlesticks, which are the green and red bars and lines that you see. I'm going to change that so that it shows up as a line. And the difference with seeing a line versus those candlesticks is that this line is just going to show you the average of about where price was at that time, as opposed to the candlestick, it's going to show you exactly what price was doing. And I switched to this time frame because the point and the things that I need for you guys to see and realize are more evident on this line chart. So when we're talking about marking up support and resistance and marking up areas where you're really looking for the market to hit those levels, as Mr. Levels calls them, those levels are going to be very apparent here. So what we're looking to mark are the mountaintops and the valley bottoms. So the peaks and troughs. So I'm just going to go in and click where I see a peak. And it doesn't have to be exact, and you don't have to mark each one. I'm just looking for ones where I see multiple touches or ones that are just kind of standing out alone. So that's good for right now. Actually, I'm gonna mark this one. There we go. And that's good. So we're on a higher time frame. So the next thing that we're going to do now is go down to the daily time frame. So now, instead of looking at weeks, this line now is going to be averaging what happens every day. So if I were to switch back to those candlesticks that we were looking at briefly, now each one of these candlesticks represents a day instead of representing a week. So that's what we'll be looking at once we switch back. And just remember that whatever time frame, whatever you click on in this drop-down menu, and this will be on your phone, it'll be on your MT4 or MT5 on your computer, it'll be on TradingView, all of those have time frames. Just remember that whatever you click on, that's how much time is going to be represented in that one candlestick, in that one bar that you see. So just remember that if you click on 5 minutes, you know, that one bar is worth 5 minutes, or we're on the daily, it's worth a day. So I'm just going to switch back to the line chart. So now those same lines that I had on the weekly chart, I'm just going to now go through and see if they're in a good spot. Are they still touching pretty good support areas, which are, think of the support as being the floor or being the chair. So are they touching good areas where price is coming down and using it as a support? A spot where it's like coming down to rest or standing. And then I'm also looking for areas where it's met a resistance or a ceiling, where it came up and touched the line and didn't break through it. So it doesn't have to be exact. It doesn't have to be perfect. I'm looking for the number of touches, especially with the line chart, because remember, I told you these were averages. So once we get down to the candlesticks, you'll really be able to fine tune and move them around to actually meet where the candlestick tops and bottoms are. So just for the sake of me changing the time frame from weekly to daily, I'm going to add another line or two, but I'm just going to put that color in green. Actually, I didn't want to change that one. Okay, so I just wanted to put a line here because the further down in time that you go, the more areas you start to realize, okay, this is a significant area that I wasn't able to see before. Also, where current price is a really good area because we have price that's kind of resting where price is, where this level is. Price is kind of resting there now. It was resting there about a month ago, and then about 2 months before that, and at the beginning of September, the middle of July. Actually, it's kind of funny. I'm noticing that price comes down and hits this area around the middle of every month roundabouts. So it's just kind of interesting. And some prices do that just based on how currency flows through the market. So those are some things to think about whenever you're trading certain pairs. But I'm just going to go down to the next time frame now and go to the 4-hour time frame. So now on the 4-hour time frame, this line is the average of price over the last 4 hours or over a 4-hour period. So as I'm looking at where I currently have my lines, I don't really need to actually do anything right now. All the lines are in good places, although I will move that one down a little bit. But as you can see here, everything is matching up, it's touching. All these little areas where you might see peaks and stuff, we can add stuff in later on a lower time frame. So this time frame on the 4-hour, depending on what type of trader you are, this is something important to know and think about when you're forming your trading plan and also when you plan to get into trades. So are you going to be the type of trader that's going to wake up in the morning and you know that you have the whole day to do whatever you want to do and you can set aside time to be in front of the charts and get in and out of trades? If you're that type of trader, then you trading 4-hour time frames and below are good. Like you can actually trade, you know, the 5-minute, the 15-minute, and the 1-hour time frames because you're going to be in and out of the market fairly quickly. If you're the type of trader, you want to find a very general trend, an overall trend for the market, and you just want to take a long-term play, which means you want to get in, you want to put the trade in, you want to set your stop loss, and you don't want to look at the trade for like a day or two, then definitely looking at the 4-hour time frame, which is what we're on now, is a good time frame to look at because price really isn't going to move dramatically on this time frame. For some pairs it does, but for currency pairs, you'll be safe for the most part with trading off of the 4-hour and the daily. And then I wouldn't trade off of the weekly or monthly time frames unless you just had a lot of money and you really planned on staying in that trade for a good like several months to a year. But we do look at those time frames because it helps us to see trend. So right now, the 4-hour time frame, I was going to ask you guys to tell me, but I'll tell you for the sake of time. We're currently in a downtrend in this market for EuroCAD. So this trend actually started back in December, and it hit its peak on December the 22nd and has been in a downtrend ever since. So what is a downtrend? A downtrend means that the market and price is starting to make lower highs and lower lows. So if you think about stairs, think about walking down a set of stairs. One stair is going to be higher than the next step that you're going down. So this high is higher than this high. And then this high is higher than this one. This one, although slot is not by much, it's still higher than this one. And then this high is higher than this one. And you can even add this high. And then for the lows, this low is higher than this low. It's higher than this low. So price is constantly making lower highs and lower lows in a downtrend. So if you're looking at the 4-hour time frame for EuroCAD, we're in a downtrend. So I'm just going to start dialing it down. This is called a top-down analysis. So we start at the very highest. We start at the high time frame. So either the monthly or the weekly, and we just start dialing it down. So now looking at it on the hour time frame, we're still in the downtrend because we're still making lower highs and lower lows. Although price is starting to kind of bottom out here. So at some point, I would expect that price will consolidate off of this level, which means that price is going to start moving sideways, which I just mentioned downtrend. Consolidation is another trend in the market. We talked about that last week. Consolidation is where price is making same highs and the same lows. So all the highs are about the same and all the lows are about the same. And here on this time frame, I am going to come back in and add a line here. And I'm going to add a line down here. I'm just changing these to red just so that you can see that there were different time frames. And so the hour, I'll stop at the hour. Mr. Levels, whenever he trades, does go down to lower time frames. I'm just going to stop here. And then we'll switch to a lower time frame, maybe the 15 minute, once I flip to the candlestick chart. So I've looked at this pair. I've seen, okay, this pair is in a downtrend. I've marked some levels where I'm expecting price to hit. And now your next step would be to flip back to candlesticks. And as you can see, whenever you flip back to the candlesticks, your line should be relatively close to where candlesticks have started to group together. And so whenever I mentioned fine tuning and kind of dialing in your levels that you marked up, this right here would be an area where I would consider moving my line, and I would potentially move it here, because this area right here actually accounts for more touches of candlesticks. So in order to have a really strong level and a really valid area of the market, you need to have at least two touches. Three or better is always great, because that just gives you more confirmation of that level. So put a one in the chart if you're following me so far. And if you're not, put the questions that you have in the chart, in the chat, I'm sorry. Cool. Okay. So from here, we have support and resistance marked up. So what I did was just mark levels. I told you guys what the definition of support and resistance was, but for the sake of trying to keep it consistent for you guys between me and Mr. Levels, he calls them levels. So he'll try to make the distinction between support and resistance, but just know that it's a level, because levels can always change. And for instance, for those who might be wondering, like, okay, what is she talking about? If you look right here in the middle of the chart, there's this area where price comes down and it's hitting this red line. So it's using it as a support. It's using it as a chair, a floor. It's not breaking below it, essentially. But we do have a candlestick that eventually breaks through it. And when it does, price then comes up to this same line and can't break above it. So when we hear Mr. Levels talking about price breaking through structure, breaking above a level, breaking below a level, and not being able to break back above it, this is a perfect example of what he's talking about. So This is just a level. Even though, yes, here for this grouping of candlesticks, it's a support, but for this candlestick grouping, it's a resistance because price can't break back above it. And so some of you might say, well, over here it did. Yes, price did break above it with this candlestick, but this next candlestick was immediately bearish and closed below it. It didn't stay above that line. So anytime you're looking for a break and a retest, which is one of the strategies and one of the methods of trading that we use, make sure that price stays above that line. So if you see this impulsive move, this green candlestick means that for that 1 hour, price was bullish, which means price went up. Make sure that when the next hourly candlestick opens, which is at the very top of the hour, make sure when it opens up above this line and stays above this line, meaning it has to close up here. None of that candlestick bar should be down here. If it is, then you need to wait. So I'm actually literally going through my trading plan with you guys. So I do top-down analysis. I figure out if the market is bearish or bullish in an uptrend or downtrend, and I find my support and resistance as I'm going on along the way. So that's why I put these different lines on the chart. So the next thing that I would do is look to see where price is. So I'm looking, where is price right now? Price is on this green line. So what is the green line? Is a significant level because, remember, I marked these red lines up on the 1 hour. These purple and green lines, I did those on a higher time frame. So the higher the time frame that you mark a line up on, or a support or resistance or a level, the higher the time frame, the more significant and the more weight that it carries. So whenever I'm on the hourly time frame, that means that levels that I marked up on the 4 hour and levels that I marked up on the daily chart and the weekly or monthly are going to carry more weight than if I had marked these levels up on the 15 minute time frame. Why is that? Because the higher the time frame, the less volatility there is in price. Price isn't going to move as fast. There are more pips in a candlestick, but it's going to take a lot longer for that group of candlesticks to hit another level. With the 15 minute time frame, when I go down and show you guys, you'll see you start to get changes in trends. So I might not necessarily be, and I can actually tell you from what I'm seeing down here, I probably won't be in a downtrend on the 15 minute chart. I'll probably be in an uptrend. And so you have to make sure that you're aware of where you marked your lines up and make sure that you're aware of where price is. That's really important. So if you have color blindness or if you have a sensitivity to color or just, you know, a lot of action going on, one thing that I recommend you do is you can go in on TradingView and you can label you can label these. So you can actually go in here and you can say, you know, higher time frame or whatever, but it'll put whatever text you want for that line right up under it. So if you want to have all of your lines blue, that's cool. You can just label each line as you go along. So TradingView is very friendly in that way. All right, so where's price now? I'm gonna go back to that, keep moving on through the steps, and then I'll come back to some of those other points that I was making about the lower time frames when we go down to the 15 minute. So price is resting down here on this support. Price came down, it touched the support 3 times. Really, if you wanna count this, the bottom of this red candlestick, touched it about 4 times. So I know that price is It has whipped down to one of my levels. Price didn't close near it, and price didn't close below it. Price actually bounced off of it. And so now what I'm looking for is to see some type of candlestick formation. I'm going to go over candlestick formations with you guys in a little bit of detail tonight. And then as time goes on, I'll be incorporating more. The candlestick Bible, for those who are in the group, it's in there. So you guys can kind of flip through and see what, you know, what it consists of, what is a candlestick pattern and all of those things. I will tell you, for the sake of trying to trade the way that Mr. Levels does and learning price action, you pretty much just need to really know engulfing candlesticks, maybe one or two more, but engulfing candlesticks for sure. And I'm going to show you that one. So I will be looking for some type of candlestick formation down here. I'll be looking for price to either show me that it's going to come back down to this level and possibly try to break through it, or come back to this level and show me that it's going to bounce off of it and try to make a reach for this level. And as far as this trade is, as far as this chart is concerned, I'm done now on the hour. I'm going to go down to the 15 minute. So on the 15 minute chart, Eurocat is actually still in the downtrend, but if you look here, that area where I thought that it could possibly be in an uptrend is actually just consolidating. So when I was telling you guys earlier about price consolidating, you see how price just came up here and across here, where price just came up here and never broke above this level, and it did it several times. It actually came up and touched this level about 8 to 9 times, and then came down here and did the same thing with this level. Even though, yes, there are wicks down there, price still has not truly broken above or below those levels. It's just moving sideways. It's not giving you any steps. So if you continue to keep the visualization of steps in your head whenever you're looking at the chart, you'll be able to know what's an uptrend, what's a downtrend, what's consolidation. If it's not making steps, if it doesn't look like what stairs look like in your mind, then it's consolidation. And so with that being said, you know, if I were trying to take a trade off of this right now, I would wait, because I don't trade, and no trader really should trade a market that's consolidating, because you don't ever know when price is going to break out. So I could say, oh, well, price is up here, it's near this level where it hasn't broken above before, I'm going to put in a sell, and price could shoot up because it's been consolidating for a couple of hours now. So just wait. You wait for the market to tell you what to do. When Mr. Level says be patient, be patient, because the market's always going to give you a move to tell you and show you what it's going to do, and then give you a retest. The retest is what you're waiting for, so then you can actually get into the market. So a good example of what I just said is right here. A lot of people would have felt like, oh my gosh, I missed this move. I missed this whole move right here. I could have gotten in the market and I could have made like, you know, I could have gotten in and had like 18 pips in like 20 minutes or so. Okay, that's fine. You could have had that. But look, price came back and retested that same level that it broke through. It gave you a really strong impulsive move, which is when we're talking about candlesticks, and Mr. Level says an impulsive move, we're looking for bars. We're looking for these really long bars on these candlesticks. It can't be the wicks. Like, you want a really long bar. You want a bar that is bigger than most of the average bars that you're seeing. So you see how these are really little? Then all of a sudden, like, you see this candlestick that's big. This candlestick is about 4 to 5 times bigger, even possibly more than that, than some of these candlesticks over here. So that's what he's talking about. Look at the average size of the candlestick that's on the chart, and then find the ones that are bigger. Those are impulsive moves. So this impulsive move broke below this level and continued to sell, but it stopped right here and came back up and retested. Had you waited for the retest and got in on that level, you actually would have gotten out with 37 pips, and that 37 pips would have happened over an hour. So that would have been $3.60 on a 0.01 lot size, $36 or $37 on a 0.1, and it would have been $3.60 on a standard lot. So, you know, if you think about it that way, always wait for the retest. The retest is always going to give you your best chance of getting in, because if you look, price just came up and wicked it and left. Like, it didn't even close anywhere near that level. So when Mr. Levels is talking about break and retest, perfect example right there. Does anybody have any questions about that? Okay. What I've seen so far, people have said no questions, but I'm gonna keep going. And then if someone does have questions, I'll come back and answer them. All right, so I told you guys we were gonna cover some indicators tonight. We were gonna talk about a couple of things you can put on your chart to help you out. I'm gonna cover moving averages. It's one of the, I would say it's one of those indicators that you'll see on an average trader's chart. Not every trader uses a moving average, but it definitely is something that you'll see, something you should know how to use and why you're using it. So let's see. I'm going to take these. So to add indicators to your chart, you would come up to indicators, and you can search, because TradingView has thousands of indicators. You would need to know the name of the indicator you're wanting to use. So to start off, type in moving, and it's going to come up. Moving average is going to be right here. This moving average is a simple moving average. They just call it a moving average. But this is a plain old moving average, just a moving average by itself. I'm gonna click that one time and come back to the chart. So it automatically sets it for 9. I'm gonna go to the settings, and under settings, you can actually come here and change that number. So what is that number? What does the number mean? How would it affect my trades? So that number is representative of how many periods. So how many, since I'm on the 15-minute time frame, it's averaging the last 9 15-minute candlesticks off of the closing price. So whenever you're looking at this line, the line is the average of the last 9 candlesticks closing price. And on my chart, anytime I hover over a candlestick up here beside of the pair, it'll say OHLC, which is the opening price, the high, the low, and the close. So you can actually find the closing price, the number for it, for that one candlestick up at the very top. So the significance of the number, I will go back and I want to go back to the hourly time frame to really demonstrate this for you guys, because whatever you're using on the hourly time frame will really help and benefit you kind of going down in time frames. So when you think about the average trading session, the average trading session in the markets is about 8 to 9 hours. So whenever TradingView has this set for 9, it's based on about how long a typical market's price will be volatile. So for the New York session, New York's money, which is the banks, they start coming in around 6:30 in the morning, start opening up, start thinking about trades for the day. They're looking at what London did overnight. And then New York's bankers, the people who are actually doing the trading, they don't leave until about 4 or 5. So when you think about it like that, when you think about traditional banking hours, you know, you think about, okay, they got to come in before the bank opens and they got to stay a little bit later after the bank closes. It's about 9 hours. So that's why they chose 9. However, there are other numbers that are important to moving averages. So the average trading week is Monday to Friday, but not everybody trades Monday to Friday. Typically, when bankers come in, they come in on Monday. They don't start trading right, you know, at the beginning of Monday, because markets opened on Sunday. So they have a little bit of a grace period before they actually really start doing their heavy duty trading on Mondays. And then Fridays, typically bankers leave a little bit early. So on average, even though there are 5 business days, 5 banking days in the US, only about 4 of those are truly used for heavy duty banking trading of currency. So the 4 moving average is significant. Also, the 50 moving average is significant. The 50 moving average is significant because whenever we look at time, when we look at the average number of trading days over the course of several months, it's about 50. And that's about in a quarter. Every quarter you can get about 50 good trading days. And that's like, you know, without your holidays, without your weekends, without your, you know, special bank days and stuff like that. And then as a rule across the whole market, 200 is your next significant moving average. And that's because there are about 200 good trading days in a year. So if there's 50 and a quarter, then about 200 in a year. So again, that's not including your weekends, that's not including holidays, that's not including, you know, banker off time, you know, all that stuff. So the 9, if you're looking at a time frame, like on the hourly, if you're looking at like a day's worth of time, kind of like what we're doing here, these are segmented off into days. Every day you get about 9 good hours within a session, you know, for viable and high volatility. You have the 4 moving average because you have 4 average trading days in a week. The 50 because you have about that many trading days in a quarter, and then 200 because you have about that many trading days in a year. So someone asked, how do you find that? So again, you come back up here to indicators. Click on this indicators button. And when you click on it, the box is going to pop up and say indicators and strategies. And just type in moving. You can type in moving average if you want to. It'll pop up. But just make sure you're clicking on the one that says moving average. You don't want exponential. You don't want weighted or smooth. You want the regular moving average. I do use the exponential moving average. I don't want to show you guys that one tonight because how you calculate it and how you look at it is completely different from a simple moving average. And just to show you a point, on the hourly time frame, these are in two different places. Make it more obvious for you guys because they're the same color right now. So I just made the exponential moving average white and thick so that it it's, you can see it better. Probably make this one thick too. Okay. So you see how these are in two different places? That's significant. Depending on the pair you're trading and depending on your time frame, the distance between those lines can move. So you see, I went down to the 15 minute. They're about the same. But if I go up to the daily, they start to get further and further apart. And remember, I said that these candlesticks hold more pips. So, you know, the difference or the gap between these candlesticks here, that's like 40 pips. Yeah, that's like 40 pips. That's a lot. That's a whole trade right there of difference between those two lines. So when I tell you guys to use the simple, please use the simple moving average until I show you how to use the exponential. And then it will be your choice because then you can see based on the pair you trade, which one hits closer to your levels and which one works better for you. I use a mixture of them on my charts. On the Bitcoin chart that I showed you guys in the group, I used a mixture of them. So that's that. And I'm going to show you guys one more indicator and then I'm going to go over the news really quick. I'm not going to cover this in heavy detail. I just want you guys to see it. It popped up down here at the bottom. It's always going to be at the bottom. It's never going to show up inside of your chart, but this is called the RSI. It's the relative strength indicator. So this helps you to see if you're in a trade, especially long-term, and you're trying to figure out what other people are doing in the market and whether or not you should get in or out. This helps. Because this will tell you whether or not the market is overbought or oversold. So overbought would be the market or price crossing this line up top. And then oversold would be this line crossing, price crossing the line down here at the bottom. I'm not going to like drown you guys with that tonight, but I did want to show it to you. And just so that you guys can see it, so whenever Mr. Level says overbought or oversold, you kind of get an idea of like what he's talking about. And as you can see, these areas kind of match up. So where price was overbought here, where it crossed this line up top, if you have your crosshairs on, you can actually look to see price actually broke through this level. And this was a level I did on a higher time frame. It came up here, but then it immediately sold down off of that level and hasn't really been back up there since. So there was a lot of buying that happened in this area. And then price reached an area where it was like, okay, we can't sustain having price at this level. And price came back down again. Okay, so to answer Mr. Carl, the moving averages. So I'll put them in the chat for you guys. So the 4, the 9, the 50, and the 200. Patrick, are you wanting me to show, what are you wanting me to show one more time?
You did. You showed it already.
Oh, okay. Cool. I'm going to go, when I go more into detail with the RSI, I'm going to show you guys my chart. I will tell you that how I label my chart is a little crude because it hits home. It lets me know, like, I need to get in, I need to get out. And it's just how I've traded when I use the RSI. So I might clean it up a little bit as far as the language is concerned on it. And I'll show you the levels that I use on my RSI. I use these levels. I don't know which levels Mr. Levels uses for his RSI, but it's just a tool. One thing I want you guys to realize about everything I just showed you is that they're all tools. Even the horizontal lines that I put on my chart, like whenever you look at Mr. Levels' chart, he used to, but not anymore because he's like a master trader now, which is an awesome thing. He looks at the chart and literally just sees what the market's doing. He sees, you know, with his naked eye, you can get there. You just definitely need to hone in and stay on these charts and practice every day. So I'm going to remove those lines and I'm going to remove the RSI because I want to show you guys these engulfing candlesticks really quick. Okay, so perfect example of an engulfing candlestick is right here. That look horrible, but you guys get the point. This green candlestick and this red candlestick. So when Mr. Levels is talking about an engulfing candlestick, we're talking about, and he's talking about a candlestick where if you look at it, the candlestick, it always has to be two candlesticks, first of all. So you're always looking at two candlesticks. You're always looking at them in a pair. So the candlestick on the right engulfs or is bigger than the candlestick on the left. So you have that example here where you have a bearish engulfing candlestick because this candlestick is bearish. It's moving down. That's what my red candlesticks mean. That price dropped during that time period. This bearish engulfing, because it's bigger than this green one, this bearish engulfing candlestick here, it's bearish and it's engulfing this green one. It can happen the other way around. This candlestick here, this green one, is a bullish engulfing candlestick. So this green candlestick is bullish, meaning price moved up during that one day, because I'm on the daily time frame now. It moved up during that one day, and it's bigger than this red candlestick in front of it. Here is another example of a bearish engulfing candlestick, and then following it is another example of a bearish engulfing candlestick. So when you read the candlestick Bible, if you choose to read it, hopefully you kind of you at least familiarize yourself with candlesticks within that reading. whenever you look at it, you know, there are people who use the whole like wick to wick, like with this candlestick here, the bottom of the wick is down here, the top of the wick is up here. Some people will say, well, it has to be wick to wick to be engulfing. Some people say it's just the candlestick body. One thing you will realize whenever you start trading is that for the most part, and all things that we're looking at, for the most part, because this doesn't apply to every situation, we're looking at candlestick bodies. Your body is where your volume is, but price did come up here and hit this high and come down here and hit this low. Everything matters price-wise. So don't discount the wicks, which are those lines that you see coming out of that box or the candlestick. Don't discount that, because it does matter. Just when you're looking at candlestick patterns, you definitely want to use it in context, because just because this wick didn't come up here and engulf the wick of this candlestick doesn't necessarily mean it's not an engulfing candlestick. This body where this candlestick opened and where it closed was bigger than where this candlestick opened and closed. Yes. So you'll find, to answer your question, you'll find that there are wicks that engulf, but don't always look for the wicks to have to engulf. If it's the body and you see that a market is starting to move in a particular type of way, like a downtrend, for these, you know, make sure that you're paying attention to where those bodies are for the candlesticks. It doesn't always have to be the wick. The wicks are good when the wicks are included, but it's not a must. And so to tell you what it means when you have these type of engulfing candlesticks, so a bearish engulfing candlestick means that it's a high probability, because in trading, we're dealing with probabilities. Nothing is ever just 100% all of the time. Mr. Levels has a really high probability, might I add, but nothing is like 100% with these candlestick formations. These formations give you probability. So when we stack candlestick formations on top of using indicators, if you choose to trade that way, it makes the probability of a trade moving in your favor that much higher. So this bearish engulfing candlestick here tells me that there's a high probability that price is going to continue to move down. And this is a daily candlestick. So to put it into perspective, just the body of that candlestick, for that one day, my goodness, it's like 300 pips. So price moved 300 pips that one day. So that lets you know, like, okay, these candlesticks mean business on this time frame. And so if you look at how price continued to move over the next couple of weeks, price did move down. And this is kind of illustrating the point that I was trying to make to you guys earlier, that if you trade off of these higher time frames, you have to wait longer amounts of time for your trades to set up and actually move in the direction you want them to. And then with this bullish engulfing candlestick, it tells me that there's a high probability that price will move up, and it did. Over the next 3 days, price moved up. So if you look at the names of what the formation is called in the candlestick Bible, if you are flipping through it, you're reading it, if it says bullish, it's telling you that there's a high probability that price is going to move up. If it's telling you bearish, it's a high probability that price is going to move down. It's telling you which direction that formation is signaling that price could possibly move in. So if you're just looking at a chart, you don't know what you're doing, looking for engulfing candlesticks will give you 50% probability, because there's a 50% chance that price could move up or down. But then if you go and add a moving average to your chart, so if I came up here and added a moving average, I'm just going to stick the 9 moving average on my chart again. If I'm saying, okay, I'm looking at price, trying to figure out what price is going to do. Now, with just the moving average and me knowing that this is a bearish engulfing candlestick, and then also knowing, okay, if price crosses below and closes below this moving average and stays down there, then I have a higher chance of this trade continuing to go in my direction. So then you start to up and add percentages. So now there's a 66% chance that this trade is going to move in your favor. So when you're using indicators, just know that they're tools. I don't want you guys to get dependent upon them. I'm just showing you how to use them, because for some people, it's nice to have that as a confirmation for where price could possibly go based on what you're thinking about with your trades. But I don't want you to get dependent. Don't get dependent upon using moving averages, because not every platform has indicators, and not all of them have the same indicators. So I want you guys to get to the point where you can look at a chart, you can say, oh, price came up, hit this level, you know, it bounced off, it's probably, or there's a, you know, a chance it could come back and retest because it's never been there before. Price retest, and then you get in and you're trading like Mr. Levels. So that's the whole point and the goal of going over all of this material. So the Candlestick Bible is in the group. Someone posted it in the group earlier in the week. I'll go back and pin it so it's up at the top. So you can just go up at the top to the pinned messages and you'll see the message for the Candlestick Bible. There's also 2 other books, or maybe another book in there also for you guys to take a look at. I spent a lot of time on going over the chart. I'm not going to spend a whole lot of time going over the news because there just really isn't a whole lot to go over. So one thing I want you guys to always remember is when I'm talking about politics, this isn't from an emotional standpoint. I'm talking about politics because politics is a very important portion of our economy. So in the group chat earlier today, someone mentioned, what things should I be looking at? What things should I get into when it comes to the fundamentals? So one thing I want you guys to know and understand, that money and currency are not the same thing. They're 2 completely different things. So when we're talking about currency, that is something that is government issued, government backed. It has a stamp, a quote. There's a whole 1,000 pages about it stored off somewhere in a library. Money is something like silver, gold. You can even put Bitcoin in there, even though we call it cryptocurrency, because money has value. It holds its value. It stores its value. You can take money anywhere. It's universal. You can go anywhere with money. You can use money anywhere. I might not always be able to use the US dollar everywhere I go. The US dollar might not be accepted everywhere I go. And if you read the dollar that you hold, it says legal tender. Someone has to make that dollar bill legal. If you follow the news, and for, I've told you guys who have followed us like last year, that India, Kenya, there was a portion of Kenya, Zimbabwe, Germany, have all been countries that have fallen victim to the legal tender. Indians woke up and the bank said, we're not taking any bills over, can't remember if it was over a 50 or a 100. So if you had all these big bills, they were no longer legal tender. You could wake up in the morning and the Federal Reserve can say, we're not taking anything higher than a $20 bill. So if you got 50s and hundreds, they're no longer money. It's just paper. You might as well glue it to your wall and use it as wallpaper. That's what currency is. That's what currency, like we use money and currency in the wrong way. Like, hey, give me some money. No, hey, give me some currency. You want currency from that person. You don't want money. I mean, us on the call, we know what it is, but we probably want money. But when most people say we want money, we're not thinking about it in terms of it's not the actual paper. It's not coin. Someone has to make that legal. The other thing I want you guys to know and understand is like how the economy actually works. So when we talk about politics, politics is super important because Congress oversees our Federal Reserve System, who writes the rules for our money. So whenever we're talking about Nancy Pelosi or Mitch McConnell or Trump or anybody in politics, it's not an emotional thing. I don't care whether you're an independent Democrat, Republican, I don't care. We're talking about that policy that the person's talking about. Who cares the ideology behind it? I care about the policy itself because that's what's black and white. That's what's going to get signed and that's what's going to get enacted. No one's going to care about that person's ideals 10 years from now. They're just going to be reading what's on that piece of paper. So today, Trump was impeached for the second time. He was impeached last year in January. Now he's impeached this year in January. First time we've had a president impeached twice. How's that going to affect our markets? Well, first of all, when you look at it from a social standpoint, people aren't happy. After what happened last Wednesday, people aren't happy. People are very volatile. People are up in arms. People are scared. There's fear in the market and people are starting to panic. So we play off of people's greed and fear whenever we trade here in the markets. So, you know, when you're starting to think about, well, how can I get in on this? Like, how can I capitalize on market times like this? Well, Trump was impeached twice. We know that for a fact. We know that there are, you know, several different things now that have to happen, which probably won't happen until after Biden's inauguration. And on Biden's inauguration day, we already know that, you know, there are thousands of National Guard troops in Washington right now, sleeping in the Capitol, sleeping in different federal buildings. So there's a very tense environment in Washington. That makes people scared because they don't know what's going to happen on Inauguration Day. People are scared because they don't know what's going to happen in their local government system. So people are starting to go out and panic buy, just like they did in the first quarter of last year. People are starting to go out and buy gas the way that they did in the first quarter of last year. And people are really starting to become fearful and carry firearms again. So last year I was telling you guys what happens in a Democratic presidency. Anytime a Democrat comes into office, it's always something about guns and gun laws. So guns and gun ammo stocks always go up, but now they're at a particularly higher high because of everything that's going on. So those, if you're into stocks, those are stocks you can look at. Also stocks for consumer goods. So that will be things like, you know, Pepsi, Coca-Cola, you know, just discretionary goods, things that people, if you see it in bulk, if you can find it in Costco or Sam's and it has a major label to it and you can trade it on the market, those are things that I'm thinking about buying. Like, obviously, you know, do your research and look into the company and stuff, but that's where my mind is right now. Also looking at oil and gas, especially going into the middle of the year, because there's an expectation that mass doses of the COVID vaccine will be available around Easter. So everyone will be able to get a vaccine that wants it. A lot of countries are saying that you can't come in on an international flight unless you have a COVID certificate, which is that piece of paper they give you after you get the vaccine. Someone signed off on it. They put the serial number for your vaccine, the type you got, how many shots you got, who gave it, when, where, all that. You have to come in with that piece of paper. And then also, we switched from a winter blend to a summer blend of gas. They make less summer blend, and the summer blend is more expensive. We use a different, we get it from a different region of the world. It's, you know, it's just different from the winter blend of oil. So all that stuff is going to be happening all at the same time. So oil prices, oil companies, gas companies, I'm looking for all those companies to start seeing a boom towards the middle of the year. And then 6 months in, I'll be looking at healthcare reform again for Biden to kind of overturn some of the things that Trump did. He's really pushing for his first 100 days to be major and overturn a lot of things that Trump did. But I suspect that Washington's going to be on guard for a while. So he's not going to, in my opinion, accomplish a lot of what he's suspecting to accomplish or expecting to accomplish in his first 100 days. So all of that is important. That's why when I want you guys just to realize when I'm talking about politics and stuff, it's not from an emotional standpoint. It's literally from what's in black and white. Just to quickly cover what happened in news today, consumer price index prices haven't changed. So inflation hasn't really hit prices of items that we typically buy every day. It literally stayed the exact same. Tomorrow, the major thing that you guys should be looking forward to is listening to Jerome Powell speak around 12:30. So that's going to be his first major speech. He's going to be taking questions. I would be very cautious and careful, especially if you're a new trader when in trading USD pairs. I honestly, if you are new to the group and you're just starting to get into trades, I would either reach out to Mr. Levels tomorrow or just not trade around that time, because prices are very volatile. So those really big, impulsive, the big candlesticks we were looking at earlier, those are the type of candlesticks that happen whenever Jerome Powell speaks. They're really big. There's a lot of price movement. You get a lot of wicks and prices hitting levels, but then bouncing off of them. So keep that in mind tomorrow around noon. This is also around the same time that London session closes. Even though it closes around 11:30, it's still fairly close to the close of London. And anytime Jerome Powell speaks and it's close to the end of a session or the beginning of a session, the session that bumps up right next to it, so in this case, London session, will extend itself. The traders will stay around longer just to hear what he has to say, and will try to capitalize off of his speech. And it's Thursday, so Thursday is the last major trading day of the week, or the last full trading day of the week, I should say, because on Friday, like I told you guys earlier, bankers really only trade about half of a day. So let's see. I'll go ahead and tell you guys about Friday. This is something I covered on Monday, but I'll just briefly tell you guys. Core retail sales, we're going to be looking at what were sales like during the Christmas spending season. So were retail sales up or down? So, you know, your favorite retail store, you know, you have Target, Amazon, Walmart, you know, all of these different places are going to be reporting their numbers, what their sales were like, and we'll be able to look at all of that on Friday. Okay, so I'm done. Thank you guys for listening. I know that was a lot, This is definitely a Zoom call you guys will want to go back and look at and review. Friday, I'm going to just recap the week. There's not a whole lot that I'm going to cover. I might talk about a few fundamental topics, like kind of giving you guys into more in more detail what retail sales are, what consumer price index is, showing you what the reports look like. It's not an expectation that you have to read these things. I do because I have to give you guys information, but I want you guys to know where to find stuff. So if someone says, if you make a post on social media and someone argues you on that fact, I want you to be able to know where to go to get it. So Friday, I'll cover that. I'll just kind of give you a brief overview of what happened. We'll follow up and see what's going on with Trump, find out, see what's going on with the inauguration for next Wednesday, fundamental topics. And then if you have anything in particular that you want me to cover, something you don't understand, something you've seen and you think is interesting, put it in the group chat, because I'll scroll through and take ideas out of the group chat and write them down, and we'll cover that also. But like I said, I appreciate you guys for listening. I'm gonna go ahead and turn it over to Mr. Level so he can go over trades and technicals. And thank you guys again.
Cool beans, appreciate you, Carmen. Great job as always. A lot of great, great, great information. Yes, sir. Jump right into these technicals. Can y'all see my chart?
Yes.
All right, cool beans. All right, let's get into it. So, as always, y'all know we start with the dollar, because the dollar gives us an overall view of the currency pairs that we trade, which are Euro USD, GBP USD, and NZD USD. So we always start with the dollar because the dollar just shows us an overall view of the market. So looking at the dollar from Monday, I told you guys that I wanted to see the dollar give us a push up to retest this gray structure right here, this gray price level. We're getting the push up. This is the daily chart. I wanna see if we can break back above this last daily candle, yesterday's candle. It's a possibility that we could see the dollar come down and retest the bottom of this structure. I mean, the top of this structure, my bad. Here. We just got that touch though. So yeah, we could see the dollar just go ahead and continue to push on up. That's what I wanna see anyway. So I wanna see the dollar get back above this structure, and then, give us a retest and keep pushing to the upside. Cause Lord knows we need it. But there is a high probability that the dollar could keep pushing south towards 70.70 cents. So we're going to see, man. We're going to see what all this stimulus do. We should see the dollar start to push back up. So with that being said, let's look at Euro USD. We know that Euro USD move in the opposite direction of the dollar. So we're expecting the dollar to keep pushing up. We know we're expecting Euro USD to keep pushing down. So looking at Euro USD, we got the break of the structure. I did want a clean, solid retest of this price level here, but just kept pushing. Then we got the pullback, but we didn't quite come up and retest it. It's all good. I'm going to see how Euro USD play out throughout the rest of the night and see if we get this pullback to retest this structure before we come down here and fill in this imbalance that we got here. This is what we call imbalance. When you see a gap like this in the market, that's imbalance. That price gap needs to be filled. So that's where I'm looking for Euro USD to be drawn to, come down and fill in that imbalance, and then give us a play for a buy off of this price level at the bottom here. So look like she pushing now. Let me see. Yeah. So I'll either be waiting for Euro USD to come and give us a buy off of the price level at the bottom, or I'll wait for it to come retest our structured area right here, price level right here, and give us a sell off of that level. Looking at GBP USD. I want to see GBP USD break through this structure, come back and give us a retest, and then push down to retest these price levels. Down at 1.3347, 1.3327. So these levels here, that's where I'm looking for GBP USD to come to. But we need to break in the retest first. So we see price do something like that. So that's what I'd be looking for GBP USD. NZD USD. Let me see some. Okay. Cool bean. All right, so I drew this up for y'all Monday night off of this structure right here. Told y'all that probably get a buy off of this price structure here, back up to retest this structure and keep selling to the downside. I told you guys I eventually want to see NZD USD come down here and fill in this structure right here. Fill in this imbalance right here within this structure. And so that's the play that I'm waiting on for NZD USD. But however, this was a good buy if anybody took that buy from Monday night's class, 50-something pips. But so moving forward for the rest of the week, yeah, I do want to see NZD USD continue to push to the downside. So moving on to metals, looking at silver. Silver came back up, gave us our retest. Now we see silver pushing down. Silver look like she's in a good opportunity for a sale right now. I do want to see silver come back down and retest the price level of $22. $22.45, $22.24 right here, right in this level. But yeah, that's what I want to see for silver. Silver's looking good for a sale right now. Gold. I wanted to see gold pull back up and retest this level right here, but it looked like gold just gonna go ahead and keep pushing on down. So I'll be looking to take a buy off of this 1786 level, 1776 level right here off of this green structure. But yeah, she pumping too. She pumping to the downside. Yes, sir. Bitcoin. Right now, I'm holding my Bitcoin and selling my Bitcoin. I see Bitcoin coming back down to retest 20,000. This level that I got right here, this is an all-time. This is the all-time high from 2018 that Bitcoin just broke last month in December. So as you can see, when Bitcoin broke that high, that all-time high from 2018, go back and show it to you. Go to the daily chart. All right, this is that 2017, my bad, I'm sorry. December 2017, we was going into 2018, but it was December 2018. So we see that high. We see that high get broken right here at 19,889. We see when Bitcoin broke that high. You see what Corman was telling y'all about when I'm talking about aggressive candles or aggressive or convincing candles. This is what I'm talking about. That aggressive push to the upside. You see, it's a nice thick candle. Then we had another one. And we don't see any selling on this side of the candle. So that means that there's imbalance there. That's what we call imbalance. Because the market likes to be balanced out. So when you see the market moving in one direction, you automatically know that eventually the market is going to come back down in the opposite direction, because we all know the laws of gravity or whatnot. What goes up must come down. So the market works the same way. So with me seeing this imbalance, I see that I only seen selling offered on this side of this move. I only see selling offered down to here. So from here, from this level to this level, there's been no selling offered in that area, only buying. This is an all-time high from 2017. So like, that's a very, 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 very strong level. So we see this aggressive move up, and then price never came back down to balance all this buying. So I already know with my experience that Bitcoin is coming back down to 20,000. It's just a matter of time. So when I seen Bitcoin hit up here at 42,000 and start to sell off like that, now I'm looking for Bitcoin to go ahead and push down and fill in this imbalance and then continue to the upside. So we'll probably see, I'm expecting to see, ain't that about a, and so forth. And that's how the market moves. It's all just time and space. That's all it is. Price action and market structure. And so, yeah, that's what I'm looking for Bitcoin. I want to see Bitcoin come down here, fill in this imbalance, and then give us our next swing high. So that's how we'll play Bitcoin. Looking at oil, I want to see oil come back down here and retest this engulfing candle right here, and then keep pushing to the upside. Last but not least, U30. I want to see U30 keep pushing to retest this level here that I got up here. I got my alarm set up here, my alert set for U30 to come up and retest that level. Then I want to see U30 come down and give me my retest of this structure that I have down here. I've been waiting for this for a minute. And so I think we might get it tomorrow and going on into Friday. So I go down to the hour. Yeah, so I want to see. I want to see it go ahead and bust up. And then give me my move down like that. So that's what I'll be looking out for U30. That'll wrap up my technical analysis. I'm gonna let Ghost do his tech if Ghost got any technicals. And then we'll take any questions. It's on you, bro.
Oh, okay, okay. Well, you know, let me share your screen right. Share my screen right quick. Hold on. Let me get it. Okay, okay. Hold on. Let me get to my. Give me a second, though. I'm trying to. Hold on. I'm trying to get okay. I didn't have it up. Hold on. Oh yeah, I did. All right. You know I've been getting difficulties pulling this Zoom screen up for us.
Oh, you good? You good, bro?
All right. I'm trying to get to the Zoom link. Open. All right. Let's share my screen now, right? Share screen. Give me 1 second, bro. This thing is just not sharing for some reason. All right. I will say this, share the screen. Can y'all see my screen? Oh no.
Yes, sir.
Yep.
All right, y'all. How y'all doing today, this evening? I'm trying to mouse on from all the things. I'm working with 2 laptops over here. Let me do this right here. I'll do this over just for the sake of this. I'm looking at US 30. I haven't really charted too much yet today. I just jumped in the cell a little above this, and I'll show you why in a minute. I moved to break even. The only reason why I didn't send a signal on this one is because it's, even though I usually do it on 2 touches, this is the 3rd touch, and I believe it has a little more to the upside to go to. But I'm going to show you what made me take the sell and what are the things I was looking for first. I started with some buys. I started with some buys, and this is, I'm going to turn to the 5-minute chart. and I'll show you what led me to take the buys. This was the gap up when the market closed earlier. But one thing about these charts is that I've learned, if you use different charts, you will, it'll be different. They'll look different. The candlesticks will look different. So I typically look at both of them now to determine certain things, because they be missing in the other one. And it could kind of make you miss a play. And I'm gonna show you right now what I mean. These is both two US 30 charts, and they're actually different. It's the same chart, but some of the candlesticks are different. And I'm gonna erase this, all this stuff, because I know where my levels is at. I could easily put that back. So I'm gonna erase this. Is my screen too small for y'all? Y'all can see it pretty good.
We're good.
Y'all good? All right. So I just want to show y'all something. Earlier, certain things I look for when I take a play. Of course, we know the US 30 was already in an uptrend. So you know the trend is your friend. We learned that. And these is two US 30 charts, which you couldn't, right here on this chart, I couldn't see that this was a buying opportunity. If you look at my crosshairs, you'll see the difference. And you'll see what I mean. I'm gonna lock this in and I'm gonna draw this, right? This right here was a buy sniper. But depending on which chart you're looking at, they're both US 30, but some of the candles are different. Depending on what chart you're looking at, you won't get to see it, if that makes sense. And I'm going to show you right here. Okay, I'm going to go here. I'm going to go this. Excuse me. It's not giving it to me on both sides. I got them locked in. I don't know why it's not giving it to me on both sides, but I'll just draw them on both sides. All right, I'll do it here. On the other side, this is the same time frame. That makes sense. But I want to show you the difference. I want y'all to see how this thing could be manipulated. All right, so this is an engulfing candle. I know y'all heard about engulfing candles with them. They was talking about it. This was an engulfing candle. And this is also the opening of the New York session. So this is a level of hold. This is a support level. So when a golfing candle came, it shot up, came back, retested this open level of New York and shot back up. Then it made another one. So it showed me that the floor was steady. So now it's bouncing on it on both sides. Pay attention to both crosshairs on both sides, because this is something I want to show you guys. It's bouncing on it. And over here, you see it built another level. These are like steps. I call these stairs to the top. This was another step that it built, engulfing when it came back, retested and shot back up. But over here, depending on what US 30 it is, even though it shot up right here, this big gap up, it wasn't no engulfing. So you wouldn't have known to take this buy right here, if you was looking at this chart instead of this one. So I don't know how many different pairs you guys trade, but I just concentrate on one, because this pays out. This does everything I needed to do for me, because when I got a whole bunch of pairs, I'm all over the place sometimes. I forget levels. I forget what I'm looking for. I'm in one trade. I can't get in the next one. So I kind of just focus on the US 30. I'll do some marking up for other people if you need me to. I'll be more than happy to do that. but I want to show you these stairways to the top with this bot. So this was a step to a new level. This was an engulfing candle. It came up, retest, made another engulfing candle. Here's a new step. You see right here, it didn't touch it. But if you go to this side, on this engulfing candle, it kissed right off of it. So me, that's why I'm now marking up both of my charts. Just say if you would have put a buy limit right here, it would have never clicked you in. But if you was looking at this chart, which is the same thing, it would have been a perfect move, another move to the upside. So these are just steps to confirm your buy levels. Like here, here, here. And now when we get up here, we have more. And it didn't push up too far, but if you look at different time frames, I'm gonna go to the 15 minute. So I look at different time frames. Like me, I consider myself a quarterback. So my 5 minute, my 15 minute, my 30, my 45, my hour, those are my receivers, tight ends. So before I pull a trigger, I make sure I go through all my time frames, all my receivers to make sure I'm making the right decision. So after we start making these steps up to the top, let me turn this to 15 minutes too. After we start making these steps up to the top, started to build up. So we have another engulfing here. It didn't come all the way down and touch it. It didn't come all the way down and touch it, but it just shows me that it's pushing up. And once it stayed on this level, that was another indication for a buy. And the reason why I took this sell up here is I'm trying to just kind of take y'all into my psyche of trading. I took this sell up here. Excuse me on this side. I took this the sell that I'm in now, and I took it up here because of this 4 hour engulfing up here to the downside. It already, and if you see my engulfings in different colors, that's because that's my different level of respect that I have for them. This is a 4 hour engulfing to the downside. It also built another one. Even though it broke through it, it's still been, the 4 hours has still been closing under it to show that it's still respecting it. Even though it taps under here, it taps up here, it's closing under it still. So this is still a strong level. Even though it's wicking up, but after the 4 hours close, it closes under it. So this is why I took my sell right in here. And I moved it to break even. It doesn't really have that much room to breathe because I know we're in an uptrend. Even though I would like to see it come all the way down to fill in the canvas that it's, because there's a lot of room. All of this got to get filled in. I would like to see it come all the way down here. I still know it's an uptrend. It may pop up more before it comes down because everybody's waiting for the sell. So if you look at the market and look how it's been doing for the past month and a half, everybody's been waiting for the sell, and it's just been popping right back up. And another thing I wanted to show you guys is how the market repeats itself, and it's been doing it for a while now as it's been climbing to the top. So this is something that you could look for to when you're either bullish or bearish in any pair. I want you to pay attention to these lines right here. All right, we're in an uptrend. We're in a big uptrend. And the first, I'm gonna put it right here, excuse me. I'm gonna go here. Let me lock this in. here, here. Oh, hold on, God. This is something that you start to see over and over, and you need to really look for this right here. Okay, this doesn't want to come off on me. Let me see. Hold on. Work with me. Let me get this off. Put too many levels up. And these is how I choose my levels a lot of times. And this is real nuggets. I need y'all to pay attention to this right here. So, okay. Every big push, this is a 4-hour chart for y'all to know. Every big push up and you get a big down engulfing candle. Once it breaks back above, if we're in an uptrend, once this big down candle takes out your all your lows from the previous candle, once it pops back up, that's an automatic buy level within, for me, and it's been working out very consistently over 80% of the time. Once you do this, you are good to take me. I always take the sell once to retest. I mean, a buy once to retest to the next level. Even if it falls in it, it's still in this candle right here. So I will put my buy here and put my stop loss under here. So once it broke through this, it never came back under here. So this was good. This was good for a buy. When you see it, it did it again. This candle right here, still uptrend. You look down, this is my buy level. Once it broke through, I took a buy. You take the buy, stop loss under. It came in here. And if you don't want to take that big of a risk, you could take your buy at the 50%. This is about the 50% of the candle. But once it busts up, there's another move to the top. Same thing right here. Came up, big push down. Soon as it broke up, this is the level. And this is the level it's been on. The market has been repeating itself with these same moves. And these are opportunities to make a lot of money. So I want y'all to be mindful of that and start looking for that. And vice versa, if it's the other way around. If it's a downtrend. If you got a downtrend and it pushes up and takes out the previous highs, once it goes under, we're good for the sell down. Same thing right here. It pushed up, took out the previous highs. Once it goes under, we're good for a sell down. Same situation, pushed up, previous highs, went under here, good for the sell down. So you guys look for that and start to look for patterns on these trades so you can know when you see it coming, even if you miss this one and miss this one, when you see it again, you know what to look for. Once it busts above it, you know it's a buy situation right here because it just did it. It just repeated itself. Here, bust through, buy. Here, bust through, buy, bust through, buy. So, I think that's a tool that y'all need to put in there and practice it, do some back testing. I don't know what kind of account you have with your TradingView where you can use your replay mode and you can back test, but that's something to use. And again, when I'm trading with the trend, my stop loss is usually I'm very more lenient with my stop loss and give it room to breathe. But up here, when I'm counter trend trading against the trend, I am, as soon as I get in profit, I'm typically moving my stop loss to BE because it might blow through it and show me it's going to continue to the upside. And I'll be looking for a buy. Like, for instance, this is the same thing right here. That's why I told you guys last night, took out the previous lows. If this thing busts through here and comes up, I'm going to be looking for this buy. That's why I moved the BE so quick, because I know when it does bust up here, if it does, I'm going to be looking to take the buy off this level right here. So I hope you guys, you know, any questions you can ask me when it bosses up here. If it bosses up here now and comes here, this is where I'll be looking to take my bot to continue up, because that is exactly what it's been doing for the last, since, what's this right here? Since November 9th. I mean, yeah, November 9th. It's been doing this. Just repetition. Uptrend, big sell down, take out the previous. Wants to come back, buy. Same thing. Big sell down, wants to come back and gets to this level, buy. The ceiling is becoming a floor, and it just keep bouncing up. So when it does break through this, if it does, before it fills in this canvas down here, I'll take a buy on this level too. So just want to let y'all know that I'll be looking out. I'll send out some signals, but I specialize in US 30. This is all I really trade. I don't trade anything else, to be honest. Maybe gold once in a blue. This has been my bread and butter. This is taking care of my family. So this is all I trade. And I'm done. If anybody got a question, you may got questions, y'all can let me know.
Woo! Oh, I ain't got no question. I just got one thing to say.
That's too much stuff.
That's too much sauce, boy. Good.
I don't get this shit for free, man. This is 101 sauce right here, man. But I just feel obligated to give back right here. This is 101,000 sauce for the second.
Good gracious, good.
I just feel some obligation right now to give back.
Yeah.
I had a great 2020.
Boy, yeah, I already know you did. You know, hey, man, I appreciate you, man. Well, y'all already know what it is, man. I hope y'all was taking notes. I hope y'all learned a lot. Y'all already know, if you got any questions, y'all can drop them in the Telegram group. Like I tell y'all every time, every call, let your friends and your family know you love them while they still here. Appreciate y'all tuning in. As always, peace and love, everybody.
Peace.
Peace.
Peace and love.
Peace and love.
Peace and love. Take care.
Thanks.
Peace.